So this is where we're going to delve into some healthy, productive discussion. I'm excited now to moderate our next panel of four distinguished guests, certainly here today, this afternoon. So ladies and gentlemen, first of all, if I could now invite the panelists to the stage. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for the director of the European Centre for International Political Economy at ESIP, Mr. Hosk Lee Makiyama. Like to take a seat here. And naturally, we also have the Director of Digital Enterprises and Consumer Policy at Digital Europe, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Damir Filipovic. Also, the CTO of Enterprise and Cyber Security at Fujitsu, Mr. Torsten Hoenke. There we are, you have the central seats. And finally, on our distinguished panel this afternoon, the head of unit of International Data Flows and Protection at DG Justice and Consumers at the European Commission, Mr. Bruno Gencarelli. There we are. Okay, so We have together about half a 30 minutes or so to discuss, share our insights, and hopefully, I'm sure by the end of this half an hour together, people will walk away with more valuable ideas and insights as well. So if I could start off with a question for Mr. Lee Makiyama. So what's the current status and issues in trade discussions?
Okay, let's start off by saying what digital technology has enabled for people who trade. What is trade? It's actually shipping goods and services and doing business outside your neighborhood, outside your country, on a fair and level playing basis. Yeah, compete wherever you can compete and to be able to serve customers wherever they are. And digitalization has been fantastic, especially for the German Mittelstand, the small and medium-sized enterprises who no longer need to invest in heavy cost in sales offices. They can actually do business through online. But what a lot of people are missing is actually, it's not only about e-commerce, and it's not only about Google and Amazon's and people trading stuff online. It actually goes very, very deep into the industrial use of internet that we heard about in the keynote speeches. Digital is not just a new channel. It's actually an entire industrial revolution. And this is something that we can see and actually feel as globalization comes closer and closer. What we see, for example, in the traditional German industry, is that actually the use of connectivity and internet exceeds the use of electricity and the importance of labor. So connectivity and digitalization is more important for export for traditional machinery companies. And if you look at the service industry, you'll see that over half of the services exports in the banking and retail and transport and whatever you do on services on a human-to-human basis, more than half of the trade is actually carried by, digitalization and internet.
Okay, thank you so much. Actually, before we go any further, I'm sure distinguished guests here, many of the audience members know who they are, but maybe it would be quite beneficial if we just go through each of you just a minute or so, just saying who you are, who you represent, and what gives you the kind of credibility to be on the panel this afternoon. So if you could just tell us a little bit briefly about you, just to give an insight to our audience members.
Yes. First, thanks for having me here this afternoon. I'm responsible at the European Commission for the policies regarding international data flows, both in the commercial area and in the law enforcement area, because exchange of data, commercial exchange, as we've just heard, rely increasingly on the exchange of data. That's also true, of course, in the security area. And this year, we have published a communication at the beginning of this year, indicating that Japan And facilitating data flows with Japan is a key priority for this year. I'm happy to say a bit more in a few minutes.
Great. Yes, so also hello from my side. I'm working since around about 18 years for Fujitsu. My home base there is Germany, Augsburg, near Munich. I'm responsible for the enterprise and cybersecurity strategy within EMEA, which means Europe, Middle East, India, Africa. I'm representing here Fujitsu because in the nowadays of the digital transformation, security is one of the most important topics you have to keep in mind. For example, security by design, but also usability. Yeah, not everyone here is an IT specialist and is aware how to work with such kind of new technologies. And we also have heard it about the fast-growing market, IT market. And yeah, this is why I'm trying to give you here also some examples about what we as Fujitsu are thinking about digital trade.
Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. Good afternoon. My name is Damir Filipovic. I work for Digital Europe, and we are basically Brussels-based trade association, which has about 60 corporate members, which are basically all household names, including over 20 Japanese companies, or let's say Japanese-parented companies, that are operating in Europe, and 37 national trade associations, including two from Germany. So I'm personally covering areas of digital transformation, privacy and security, and also consumer protection, which I think is a nice mix for today's discussion.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and I'm Jose Klimakiemer, and I'm a head of a think tank called the CIPE, which is focusing on international trade. And I've been analyzing and commenting on international trade pretty much for most of my career. And I answer questions straight away when I get them.
Okay, so we move on to another question here. So I'm going to direct this one for Mr. Filipovic, in fact. So what are the expectations and recommendations to digital trade discussions and policies from an industry's perspective, from an industry's point of view? What would you say, Mr. Filipovic?
I think it was very good that we heard basically from the governments and from the country that is leading G20 this year and the country that led G7 last year, that actually digital trade is very important. It's becoming more and more in a focus, also with the key principles that are already mentioned. And I think that, first of all, now with EU-Japan free trade agreement, I think this principle can be basically enshrined and used further as some sort of the gold standard for the future, including, of course, discussion on data flows. Second thing is that, why is this important? Important is because Mr. Giancarelli also mentioned, obviously Commission, even if we would just look privacy aspects, already understood that Japan is partner that is worth and actually credible to get into these discussions. We already have ongoing discussions on a free trade agreement, so I think it's actually really golden opportunity with one stable partner that is doing business in Europe for over 60 years, and it's a very credible. I think this is a great example to do. I think that on the principles of data flows, they're already built basically in WTO GATS principles, so they already exist, so it's not something necessarily new. They have to be reinforced, they have to be basically applied. And since we basically have now in Europe new data protection rules, which are basically solid rock, we will have to comply with this. This, I think, is a great opportunity that we now combine this both and apply in principle. And like was also already mentioned, there are great G7 principles from the last year's ICT meeting, and we hope that, that this year we will have some sort of continuation and improvement from G20 as well.
Okay, we move along now. So in terms of challenges, many challenges, I'm sure every single person on the stage here has faced many challenges, and those, I'm sure, we're facing those daily. So I'm going to direct this question now for Mr. Honke. Can you give us some concrete examples of necessities and barriers that you faced in your business, Mr. Honke?
Yes, I can. So I want to hand over to you a use case of trust, agility, and also of compatibility. I think everyone here remembers about 2011 and the very different difficult word, the very terrific earthquake in Japan. And the disaster was enormous. But this is, in my point of view, a very good example to show you how digital trade can work. Because we were able to switch our complete factory from the eastern of Japan, which was affected, to Germany. Because we are also manufacturing in Germany, in the heart of Europe. And this wasn't easy, wasn't not really easy, but we are able to switch within 1 week.
So you did all this in just seven days.
And we have switched the complete factory from Japan to Germany, also the exchange of the industrial production data and a lot of other stuff. We have a very close partnership, for example, with our suppliers, which also helps us to do this shift so fast and right in time. And this would only be possible at 2011 because of the catastrophe which stands behind of this. But this shouldn't be a single one. This should be not a standalone. This should be the rule. And I'm absolutely know that the Commission is really working on it, very close also together with Japan, to bring and to enable us as companies to hand over such switches, also such digital trades.
An amazing, certainly amazing thing to do in just 7 days. Actually, I'd like to open that question up for the whole panel here. One of the challenges you've faced in the business, in your business.
Well, I'm not on the business side, but I am an economist, so I can see what it actually does to an economy. As more and more trade goes towards the internet, and as I mentioned before, the more interconnected our economies have become, the more we are dependent on the open connectivity and our ability to conduct business without any disruptions. It enables amazing thing that we heard from this example from Fujitsu, but it also means that we need to have stable regulations without no discrimination. Just to give a picture of what we're talking about, the amount of money that is at stake for Europe, it comes close to somewhere around €500 billion per year that comes in this way from the connectivity, from digital services trade. And that sounds like a lot, and it is. I mean, just to put it in the context, we are talking about more money than all the European companies paid out in dividends to all its investors. So in a sense, you can say, yeah, it's great that we have these new business opportunities in all over the world, but also it means that data localization, different type of discriminatory treatment, blockages of services, all kind of internet disruptions that governments can do on a discriminatory basis can actually make it impossible for our small and medium-sized economies and as well as small firms and big firms to actually continue business. And that also means that this money that comes into Europe is what we need to keep Europe afloat for our welfare. And frankly speaking, it's not only about the dividends that I mentioned. Without this money coming in, basically the entire European balance of payment would go negative. We would have a financial crisis.
Mr. Filipovic, I can see you nodding your head in agreement. Would you like to share with us your thoughts?
What I think Mr. Mori rightly pointed out is that the internet should remain one, let's say global internet. Of course, that we need to take into account the various risks and security and so on. That's very important, especially in protection of the privacy. But I would say also trade secrets as well, which was also mentioned. The key point is, like Osuk also mentioned, to keep, like they were said in the famous movie, the spice must flow. I would say, the data must flow in a way. And we need to find, I would say, perhaps sometimes even creative ways to keep it flowing and to keep basically our economies open. Otherwise, we will just give some, let's say, more, let's call them rogue regimes, a bit of an excuses that actually they would use our level of protection, saying, oh, you have great protection in Europe, we will copy it, but they will copy it in their own special way, which will actually close their markets. That's what we don't want to see. So yes to the high level of protection of their personal private data, but no to any type of the excuses to use this basically for the, well, blatant protectionism.
Okay, Mr. Giancarelli. Challenges.
You're asking about challenges, but today I think we can rather speak about opportunities when it comes to the EU and Japan. Both the EU and Japan recognize that in the digital era, promoting high standards of privacy and facilitating trade are not mutually exclusive, but go hand in hand. In a moment, in an era where our exchanges rely increasingly on personal data flows, and at the same time, our consumers, and that's true for the EU, that's true for Japan, our users, our consumers are increasingly aware of their personal data, are increasingly cherish and value their personal data. And that's why we need we need to have the standards of protection for as a requirement, as a condition for stable, secure, and competitive commercial flows. This is what our respective constitutional values and our respective commercial interests demand. And we have now a unique opportunity between the EU and Japan, because we have both the EU and Japan in the last years, because they are facing the same challenges, because they are trying to seize the same opportunities, have reformed their data protection legislation, and they have done this on the basis of a common set of principles. And it is on that convergence that we need to work to further facilitate data flows, and that has been recognized today. As I said, it has been recognized by the Commission in a communication beginning of this year. It has been recognized today by an important joint statement between, on the one hand, Vice President Ansip, Vice President of the Commission, and Commissioner Jourová, and on the other hand, Minister Seiko, Minister Ota, and Commissioner Kumazawa, which recognize that in the coming month, Japan and the EU will work on that very important issue.
Okay, I'd just like to hear from other panelists what their take is on what we've just heard in terms of data flow in free trade agreements.
Well, I absolutely agree that free trade agreement should not challenge democratically decided rules for privacy. I absolutely agree. They are non-negotiable. I really recognize the fact. But I also must add the point that trade rules cannot touch our privacy rules. Let me explain to you a reason why. Because they are untouchable simply because, frankly speaking, EU and Japan's privacy regimes, they are not discriminatory. They don't break the rules of the WTO and existing free trade agreements. They can withstand any challenge based on trade law. So what I'm going to say is that there's no certain, by any measure, there's no risk posed on our system on privacy and protecting our consumer privacy on the basis of trade agreements. That's very important to bear in mind. So if we don't have an issue between EU and Japan and other countries, why do we need these provisions? That's a very good answer. There is a very good question. I think there are two different approaches that we need to bear in mind. One is that Japan is a trusted partner. Mm-hmm. So we can do things with Japan that we can't do with other countries. Yes. And frankly speaking, we trade more with America and China, but they have a completely different constitutional structure than we do. So in that sense, we can do more with Japan. We can have the adequacy decisions that we are talking about. That's one thing. So in free trade agreements, that's something different. In free trade agreements, we need to agree on common lowest possible standards, lowest common denominator, if you like, with countries that we don't agree or share constitutional structures with. So that's where we need those provisions. And in that sense, you can say, well, Japan may not be the target. It's actually partnering with Japan so we can together create a rule against countries like Indonesia, Philippines, or United States or China in the next step, if we ever negotiate a full trade agreement with them. So in that point of view, I think we need to look a little bit further Japan has been instrumental in setting global standards and partnering with us in other areas of digitalization, but also in traditional manufacturing. Without Japan, we haven't been able to create a common standard in any industry. So this is the reason why Asians actually look to Japan rather than Europe for a shared common experience. And this is the reason why we need free trade agreements against third countries, not necessarily Japan. And we need to open up those economies that I mentioned with the help of Japan. Otherwise, we get thrown out. And then we lose all these profits that I said that we are depending on.
Okay, Mr. Filipowicz, Mr. Honke, are you in agreement with that?
Yes. Yeah. I mean, the key is really, like Osuk said, you know, that we keep free trade agreements, keep it what needs to be there, and not burden these agreements would actually not need to be there because of the other third countries. Because we saw already with the US that, first of all, free trade agreement didn't get through. Actually, it didn't get nowhere. And the second of all, even the adequacy decision for the private data flows was, I mean, it was done. We believe it's solid. But the thing is, it was very difficult because of difficult systems. With Japan, we have, comparable. Let's put it... Yes, we can say more comparable systems than with the US. In the US, it's totally different constitutional regime. In Japan, you can find similarities. You can say, okay, yes, in Europe it looks like this, in Japan it looks like this. You can find a bit more. And this is why we believe that free trade with Japan should basically remain free trade with Japan and not have some sort of specific carve-outs for this or that like we saw in some other trade agreements, like, you know, for example, audiovisual services and so on.
I totally agree. Commercial talks on the one hand and the privacy talks on the other hand are separate tracks. But they can complement each other. Because by having, for instance, an adequacy decision, which is a decision that ensures the free flow of data, you are facilitating commercial exchanges. And it's that quite unique momentum that we have now with Japan, because we have trade talks, and at the same time, we have reformed, both the EU and Japan have reformed their privacy system, the data protection system. And therefore, we can now build on that convergence and fully benefit from that synergies, from those synergies that come from having those, yes, separate tracks, and they should remain separate tracks, but we can make them not only going in the same direction, but producing tangible outcomes, which indeed could benefit both businesses and individuals. Because when we are talking about privacy, we are talking about effective continuity of protection when the data flows, and flows, first of all, in the context of commercial transactions. So that's that synergies is probably something we should develop in the coming month, and that's I think the whole and that's why this statement of today is so important.
Okay, so we've already kind of touched upon it already, but if I was to ask you, what are your real expectations for this EU Japan cooperation? What would you say? And I'd actually ask that. I'll open that up to all of us here. So we start with you, Mr. Filipowicz.
I would say that definitely we see that EU-Japan free trade agreement should be basically concluded. We are not entering, of course, into the political discussions, and you know there are many things, of course, to be done there. But we believe that this is something that needs to be done, hopefully within this year. We hope that basically digital issues and, let's say, digital trade will be properly reflected there, like we were actually all discussing today. And I think that, like many people mentioned today, this will also become a basis of a good, let's say, continuation of already existing broader cooperation between European countries and the EU and Japan in standards, in technological development, and basically development also of internet, and now development of data and data economy. And this is where I think that Japan can be a great example that EU can use for future future agreements, because like we, I think, all agree here, at least I didn't see anyone kind of opposing to that is that we simply have common level of understanding, respect, trustworthy systems, and ongoing decade-long cooperation. And I think that there is no any reason why we shouldn't simply capitalize in a positive way on for both sides.
Okay, Mr. Hunke.
So yes, from my side, and I'm also think this may be a good example for the rest of the world for harmonization of standards, of regulations, and all and everything. So you can see it in another example. For example, the ICAO, yeah, International Aviation. Yeah, there you have global regulations which are accepted from every country. And if we are having this at first with Europe and Japan together, yeah, this will be ideally example that it can work, also on a broader base in terms of harmonize the digital trade and also all the regulations behind and around it.
Okay, Mr. Giancarelli.
Well, let me say that I share what has been said by my co-panelists. This work is important not only for the bilateral relationship, which is of course essential, the EU-Japan relationship, but it is also essential because we are like-minded countries, or like-minded partners, sorry, in this area. And the whole question of privacy, of international standard in the field of privacy is increasingly important in the international agenda, in G7, in G20, in OECD, name them. And by showing that we can come closer and converge, we can certainly, Japan and the EU, shape those contribute to the shaping of to shape those international standards and on such key issues for not only for the digital economy, for the digital society as a whole.
And finally, a last word to Mr. Lee Makiyama.
Thank you. Now I'll separate the two tracks, as Bruno was saying before. In terms of privacy, I think it's very clear that we can't be any more like-minded. This is our best partner in Asia, the most exciting part of the world where the majority of the growth is going to happen. Let's be very clear. The Japanese consumers and users have nothing to fear from EU regulations, and we have nothing to fear from Japanese regulations. If we can't trust each other, no one in the world can trust each other. Let's be very clear about that. But then, since we have that trust, the key question is, what should we do in our free trade agreement? And I absolutely think, once again, our common interest is to make sure that other countries' regulations in the future FTAs that Japan is going to make, as well as we are going to make, we will assure that they remain as open, as non-discriminatory as our systems. So the key question is to make sure that they have enabled openings to make it data able to flow in emerging economies on our terms without putting our consumer at risk. And that's where I'm saying our EU and Japanese regulations are non-discriminatory. They open up, they enable international transfers on the basis of our regulations without compromising our regulations or standards. We need to make sure that other countries have those openings as well. So this is the reason why I think we need a very high standard FTA, which doesn't really shy away from the fact that we need to make sure that our businesses can open up those other countries if they are closed. They need to be at our standard of openness at least.
Right, we have heard lots of valuable insights, and it's great to really hear your views and opinions, and I think you'll agree with me, those of you that are watching streaming online or those of you that are right here with us this afternoon, we've certainly walking away now with more insights and ideas for the future. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Mr. Lee Makiyama, Mr. Dami Filipovic, Mr. Torsten Hunke, and Mr. Bruno Giancarelli. Thank you so much. Stay here.